continue the series today. Songs, you know, Make Me New is probably my favorite among this set for what we're trying to say. But I want to take us to that concept that we read about in Romans chapter 12. Have you ever found someone who wants to be better? And our first response to that is, well, yeah. But you do understand, especially those of us that have been sick, you know, for weeks on end lately, you know, better is, you know, 99 instead of 103 temperature. You're better. So why don't you feel better? Better is coughing only during the night instead of all day and all night. And somehow after a little bit of that kind of better, you know, you realize there's more to life than being better. And so as Paul talks about what it really means to live a Christian life, he comes to the end of, and not really the end, but it seems like the end of Romans, and gives this charge to his Roman Christians. He says, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good, acceptable, and perfect. Now that's quite a charge. But that word transformed is what I want us to focus on a little bit this morning. There, who wants to be a worm? It still looks like a worm, right? Okay, well, I picked the monarch for a reason. It's my favorite. That butterfly is the most beautiful. But the problem is, as the transformation process takes place, and by the way, in Greek, be transformed is, in Greek, the actual word we use for this process, metamorphosis. And that's what Paul's talking about. He's not talking about, well, you know, you're really a wretched, ugly sinner, and God wants you to be better. No. Less wretched and less ugly and less wicked may be an improvement, but not to the people who have to put up with that. So God does not call us to be better. He calls us to be transformed, to actually make this metamorphosis come back, like being a crawling creature and fly and be beautiful. So that's where we're at this morning. Next. Transformed. Three things about this passage. As Paul has started talking to us, he says, by the mercies of God. I urge you by the mercies of God. I used the phrase last week, we get to repent. We are allowed to transform because of God's mercy. You know, people aren't like that. People don't let us change. You'll read on an average day 1,000 times all over Facebook, people will change, people will change. That's conventional wisdom. That's the experience of people who try to do this without God. It is a sad reality in many, many cases. But where God's mercy is allowed to operate, transformation can take place. And secondly, being transformed is not fatal. Now it's a living sacrifice that's supposed to be fatal. If I offer myself as a sacrifice, I'm offering myself to die. And of course, Paul has said in Romans in chapter 6, we die to sin. This mortal body that can't survive anything in this world has to be transformed, and it has to take on a new nature. And in that transformation process, sin dies within us, but we are allowed to continue living and changing. And thirdly, he talks about how this process is voluntary. Present yourself. God does not hover over the world, zapping people and choosing them in that sense against their will. God does not go out and search and destroy people to make Christians out of. God offered His Son, and God invites us to respond to that love, to that mercy, and we present ourselves. One of the most humble acts that happens while we're gathered together is someone walking down the aisle and sitting in front of us. Do you have to do that? No. In fact, you don't ever have to do that. So you know when it happens, it's pretty special. Because someone is presenting themselves and saying, I got something that I need to stop doing. I've got something I need to start doing. I need to be a Christian. But this is a voluntary transformation. And it comes because we present ourselves. Now, I want to go back to verse 2. Because Paul says, and highlighting the first phrase, do not be conformed to this world. The picture that I zoomed in on is a picture of a butterfly. But can you tell it's a butterfly? Because it's the shape of a cocoon. The butterfly that ought to have a wingspan is conformed to the cocoon. Even when it turns the right color, it's still that shape. And Paul says, you know, the world wants to put you in its mold. The world wants you to be the shape of the world. And God wants you to spread your wings and be something completely different than you. Now, if you stop in this process of wanting to be better, and you don't make it all the way to the real transformation, you'll find yourself changing but conformed to the shape of the world. So what that involves, I think that it's important for us to understand, because this is a voluntary process, it involves rejection. Not rejection of God to us. Rejection that we look at the world and say, I don't want that. I'm not going anymore. I can't be friends with you anymore. I have to change. I can't change if I keep doing everything the way I've always done it. That's not change. That's called trying to be better. And your temperature may go down, but you're not going to get healthy. We have to reject what the world wants to offer. We have to reject what the world wants to pull us into. We have to reject the shape the world says we should be in. If we're going to be transformed. And then the second phrase in that verse is that we are transformed by the renewing of our mind. And so it involves the renewing of the mind. Now, this is so complex, because throughout the passage, I mean, he's already said, present your body. And now he talks about a renewed mind. And then he says it's a spiritual service of worship. Hey, it's complete, right? It's all of us. But the part that gets renewed is the part between our ears. Because our body goes where our mind tells it to go. And hopefully our mind tells our body where to go based on what the Spirit compels it to do. But if we don't start thinking differently about the things around us, then there will be no transformation. If the butterfly inside the cocoon says, wow, I'm a new color, I'm all kinds of colors. This is really neat. And there's no struggle. You've ever seen that? Then the cocoon continues to hold butterfly. And we have to push back against the world. We have to struggle against the cocoon. We have to go into another shape. Our mind has to think about things in a different way, or there won't be real change. Now, I'm going to mention three things here, because I really believe these are involved in the passage. But one is the presence of God. I urge you, in view of the mercies of God, that's why we come together. Can you eat some cracker and drink some juice at home or at the lake or somewhere else? You can't. You can't do it without Christians because we're here. And so we come here to say all at one time, in unison, God is alive, God is present. We have come to honor Him above everything else that we could do this morning. His presence is powerful. And the mercy's there, yes. The power for our lives is there. The spiritual renewal is there in the presence of the Lord. And so we seek His presence. And wherever you are, yes, God is there. And therefore, the process can continue. But it is the presence of the Lord that drives the renewal. The second thing about the process is the whole idea that we need to meditate. This needs to go over and over in our minds. A renewed mind is a mind that begins to envision something and begins to experience it as if it's already true, begins to practice it so that you can taste the truth of it, and then begins to get good at it so that you know it's proven, as he says, you've proven what the Lord God is. You know it's true. And that is a process of meditation. Again, it's more than the mind, but it's fundamentally in the mind. And in the heart, we dwell on the presence of God. We live as though God is watching, and that is a meditation process. Not just an awareness, not just a fact. It's something that drives how we actually live, and how we actually think, and how we actually behave. Meditation. And then there is, thirdly, a receiving process that goes on in this renewed mind. Because we're offering our bodies as a living sacrifice, God's mercy is operating, and part of what we receive, of course, number one, that is the forgiveness for the wickedness that we have committed. And then we continue to receive grace as we practice something we're not good at yet. And like in Little League, when the little one swings and the ball goes, you know, 10 feet, and everybody goes, yeah, it's great! No, it's pretty average, but yeah, it's great! But that's grace. That's grace. That's how parents feel about what their kids do. That's how God feels about our feeble attempts sometimes. Because we're going in the right direction, we're doing the right thing, and He gives us that grace to keep trying. And of course, the receiving just goes on as He provides literally for us, as He provides the encouragement of others around us. So much provision. And this is all part of the renewed mind. I begin operating in a sphere that includes the spiritual. I've offered my body, I'm renewing my mind, but wow, this is way beyond just me. And then the last part of the verse is proving what the will of God is. Now, the good, acceptable, and perfect describes the will of God, okay? Here's the thing. If you're a commandment obeyer, you say to your friends, I'm a Christian now, I can't do that anymore. God doesn't want me to do that. That's a fact. Okay? How's that working on the will and on the behavior and on the emotion? Not so much. In fact, sometimes people begin to say, well, you know, God, I'm a Christian, I really can't do much of what I used to do. And it has to be proven that that's really a good thing. That's really good for us. It's acceptable what God's will is. He's not trying to just impose things on me. He's trying to show me that the things that I gravitate toward are good for me, and His way is acceptable, and it is actually perfect, and that word is the word complete. God does not partly transform us. God does not take us to the cocoon, and it's just about to let go so I can fly it. No, that's good enough. We'll reach you there for eternity. No, he does the complete transformation process. Sometimes it takes a lifetime. As we read in the Bible, we read about characters that change. I wrote about a couple of them in your heart. It is a process that takes time, but it is a complete process, this transformation process. And so when Paul wrote in the Corinthian letter about this idea of transformation, and these, by the way, are two passages that really discuss it. It says the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. You get your wings. Liberty. Freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, and he's been describing Moses wearing a veil and he went off the mountain so that his shining face would not show. But we're beholding as in a mirror the glory of God. And we're being transformed into the image that we see in the mirror. From glory to glory. Just as from the Lord, the Spirit. From glory to glory. The transformation process works better, or works and gets more complete and more complete and more complete. There's glory, there's more glory, there's more glory. It is an increasing process. This process of transformation, and the way we get there is beholding the Lord. Looking at Him, I'll come back to that. There are false transformations, and I know you're not going to believe where I got that picture. You can't make a bug throw a human chaff. That's not physically possible. But spiritually, it happens all the time. Let me read this passage real quick. 2 Corinthians 11. Such men are false prophets, deceitful workers, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. And no wonder even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. So it's not surprising that servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness, but their end will be according to their deeds. Satan throws a shadow, and that's why I like that picture. There is the appearance of transformation. He looks like an angel of light. That sounds like a really good idea, except it isn't. People who represent Satan but claim to represent Christ appear to be transformed, but it is not a true transformation. How can you tell? You don't look at the shadow, you look at the bug. In this passage, you look at the deeds. Satan can fear God, but Satan can't live with God. Satan has a lot of powers. His people have a lot of powers. But they can't live truly transformed lives. You don't see the change that actually occurs. The behavior doesn't get better. Now, don't confuse this. You can't say, well, you know, Christians still sin, so therefore they're not Christians. We should always be careful when we judge and say, that person's not a Christian. You can decide whether to follow that or not for your own good. As Paul talked about here. But we don't make that judgment. And so what Paul describes are people who are deceiving, who act only in an imitation, and I don't mean imitate Christ, I mean you're just an imitation. You know, like imitation butter. Margarine. Yeah, it's not. It's not the real thing. It's just imitation. It just looks like it. And the function is there's no change. And so this person is unchanged, and therefore you know this is not an angel of light. This is someone who is also transformed. John the Baptist dealt with this. I'm going to read this passage. It's actually several verses. Luke describes John's preaching in such a way. that the crowds were going out to him, and John starts yelling at him, because John's very tired of him. Preacher, you brood of vipers, you bunch of snakes. Who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? So you need to bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Don't begin to say to yourself, we have Abraham for our father. I say to you that from these stones, God is able to raise up children of Abraham. Indeed, the axe is already laid in the root of the tree, so every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown in the fire. That's on the crowd of questioning him. Then what shall we do? That's kind of an interesting question, isn't it? You mean you don't know what repentance looks like? No, they didn't. And so John specifically gives examples from those who are coming to him. And each one is identified. Yeah. He would answer and say, the man who has two tunics is to share with him who has none, and he who has two is to do likewise. And some tax collectors also came to be baptized. And they said to him, teacher, what shall we do? And he said, collect no more than you've been ordered to. Some soldiers were questioning him, saying, what about us? What shall we do? And he said, do not take money from anyone by force or accuse anyone falsely, but be content with your wages. Now, I don't preach enough like that. I told you last week, I hate lessons like this. And I got chided several times for saying that, but that's okay. Yeah, it's okay for you to chide. The reason is because if I were to name everything that we do that's outside the will of God, I could put it in this room. I could make you so mad you'd never walk the path. Am I supposed to do some of that? Apparently. But here's the tension. People come to Christ and they say, yeah, we want to be Christians. And Christ says, well, yeah, what about that? What about that part of your life? Is that up for grabs? Are you going to present that one? And John was out there with people saying, you know, you got to stop being the way people say you are. Tax collectors collect too much. Stop it. Soldiers do things by force. Stop it. You can't do that. That's not repentance. And I picked out three words to describe this. I mean, John just names kindness, integrity, and commitment, and contentment. That's three things that were missing in the lives of those who were coming. He says, you know, you can't do that. You've got to do this. Transformation means there's a noticeable change. And yeah, it's gradual. It is. And it may take a lifetime. And by the grace of God, the number of years you live will coincide with the number of years you need. Change. And life will be interrupted in the middle of the process. We'll be finished. And grace will say, good enough. Because God is interested in the process of change. It's all it takes back in this closing slide to the idea of looking at the presence for the motivation to change. In 1 John chapter 3, verses 2 and 3, beloved, now we are children of God. That's important. See, that's why you don't say, you're not a Christian, you don't act like one. No. Someone in the middle of the process that's making the effort, that's receiving the grace of God, is a child of God. John doesn't mince words on that. It has not appeared as yet what we will be. What will you look like when God is finished with you? But we know when he appears, we will be like him because we will see him just as he is. Everyone who has this hope fixed on him purifies himself just as he, Jesus, is pure. I believe this passage is actually talking about the final moment of transformation that occurs in the coming of Christ. Or at death. when we see him, when he appears, when faith becomes sight, we know exactly what it is we were trying to live like, and it's like whoosh, and it's there. That's where we are. We receive a new body, we receive a new existence, we're the same person, but we were the person changing to be just that. But I believe it also says the way we get there is looking at Jesus. The Hebrew writer said, fix your eyes on Jesus. He sacrificed his life, everything about him, but fix your eyes. The things that you look at that aren't about him take you other places. You fix your eyes on Jesus, you'll go the right direction. You'll do the right thing, even if it takes more than once. How about you? Is transformation your goal? Are you just content with what you have? Wouldn't you like to get what God has in mind for you? If that process is scary to you, it's scary to me too. And that's why we come together, to encourage each other through the scary parts and the hard parts and the times when we're not doing it as we should. And you need to be one who says, I present myself, how can I truly be transformed? We invite you to come. We invite you not to delay, to do it now. While we stand, promise.